Get Ready With Me, in which I have to explain at the beginning where, it's been a while since my last Get Ready With Me. I don't know why. Get Ready With Me's are like the easiest, most enjoyable types of videos for me to make, but for some reason I guess I just get so caught in doing vlogs and reviews and idol looks that I forget about these sorts of videos. I was also debating what look I was gonna go for, and I figured I would do the one that, because when I was in California, I originally meant to, I actually filmed a Get Ready With Me there, but it was all over the fucking place and I wasn't happy with how it came out. And some people asked me on Instagram how I created that, this one look right here, or if I would be, so I'm doing it here, I'm doing it now. I'm gonna use a lot of the same products I was using, because I actually got into a routine when I was in California, because I didn't have all my makeup with me. I was forced to use makeup that I kind of already had with me, that I brought with me, and some of the things that I bought while I was there. Actually, a lot of these things I bought while I was in America. So I'm gonna be using those things. Again, I will link them down below just for reference. It's not me telling you to buy this stuff, it's just... So I applied the MAC Strobe Cream. Not really for like, well, obviously, because I want glow, but I'm gonna be using powder anyway. So I'm using it mostly for like making sure my skin doesn't look too powdery and dry after all the makeup is done. It'll help it look more glowy throughout the day. I'm gonna use the Naked Face Cushion. Fucking course. But honestly, I could probably even just go on with just this cushion, because this cushion is so fucking glowy that I don't even need the MAC Strobe Cream underneath. Just for reassurance. Oh god, that's... I don't know if you can hear that. Can you hear this? Probably can't. I can only hear it in my head. Whenever I'm like doing... It's been about a little over two weeks now? Almost 3 weeks since I got my surgery. My rhinoplasty, if you haven't heard already or found out. And when I'm doing my makeup and I'm like tapping the side of my nose, sometimes I think it's like the insert, the silicone insert that they put. I can hear it like squishing inside my nose, and it's really disgusting actually. But yeah, that's been my life lately. Squishy noses. Some people, I guess they don't watch my YouTube channel. They just saw the photo I posted, this photo, and then they saw the photo after, and I think your surgery was a waste of time and money, because your nose looked exactly the same. But literally, it was just like two photos after that one nose brace photo, and so they think they can automatically tell the difference, when really, you can't see much of a difference, because one, the swelling is still there. You see the full effect maybe 3 months in, and two, wouldn't I want it to be more like just an enhanced version of my original nose, you know what I mean? I don't want it to look like drastically different. From the side, you can definitely tell a difference. Right here. Whenever I take photos now, I'm just like... But yeah, at this point, it doesn't really... I think either today, maybe by tomorrow, I'll be at the point where I can touch my nose without it being like, it's not painful, it's just like uncomfortable, and like I don't want to touch my nose. Okay, and then to brighten up... Actually, I don't know if it's gonna brighten up, because I don't know if this is lighter than the actual cushion. I'm just gonna at least conceal my under eyes. Oh my god, I might have put too much. Okay, what else? I'm just gonna set under my eyes with this. I'm gonna use two different powders. I'm gonna use this MAC Prep and Prime, which is really, really, really mattifying. So I'm only gonna use it under my eyes, and then for the rest of my face, I'm gonna use a loose powder foundation that I showed in that video where I showed how to cover my bruises. Can you tell them what that is? And then the other powder in the rest of my face. But today I actually wanted to talk about something that... It's not like a topic that, you know, people are talking about, but I've just been watching a lot of music videos lately because I've been bored. And in the comments, I'm always seeing these sorts of comments about, oh, this song is so great, like, high key, real salty that it didn't get number one, etc, etc. You know, comments like that on these, like, especially like rookie groups. They're like, oh my god, I don't know why they didn't do so well, this concept was so good. Even like groups that, you know, aren't super new. And the thing is, I think I also talked about this on Instagram Live. The thing is, the K-pop music industry is real, real, like, they ain't fucking around, y'all. They ain't fucking around. And the thing is, there's like a huge distinction between the global market and like the Korean market. What a lot of people don't realize, because people will be wondering, oh, why didn't this song get number one? I thought it did so well, like it has this video has so, millions of views. But if you notice, all the comments will be from like English speakers. You know what I mean? But what's an example? A really good example of this is that in Korea, a lot of people didn't really take notice of BTS until like Blood, Sweat, Tears. Like even Outa, who's in the industry, he was like, oh, I didn't really know about them until like I found out about Blood, Sweat, Tears and realized how big they were. And that goes for a lot of Koreans. And the thing is, these groups have such, I'm trying to form sentences. These groups have huge followings in the foreign market, but they just don't, you know, they don't really suit the Korean taste of music because it's very different. People like Card, even, oh wait, here's an example. You know the song I by Taeyeon did phenomenal in Korea. It blew up the charts everywhere, etc., etc. But then her song, I think it was Why that came after that. Of course, it's SM. Of course, if you're from JYP, SM, or YG, it's gonna do well. But even then, for like their standards, they don't do as well depending on the music that they make. So when Y came out, it did well, but it actually didn't do that well in terms of, especially for like Taeyeon, where she is as an artist. Like it didn't do well by Taeyeon standards, if that makes sense. And so a lot of these groups, people are like, oh my god, why are these people sleeping on Astro? Oh my god, why are people sleeping on etc, etc, I don't know. Oh, Monsta X, oh my god, Monsta X, they're like, Monsta X, Starship is a rich fucking company, like they have a lot of fucking money. But I don't think they're like properly, it doesn't come down to only just a marketing, but in general, like historically, I've been into K-pop since like Girls' Generation, like G and like Kata's Honey. I don't want to be like that bitch, but like I've been there since like the beginning, nearly, not the first generation of K-pop, but like more like the second generation. And historically, and what I've noticed is that groups that do more girly, cute, very Korean sounding music tend to do better. Now there is an exception with SM, YG, JYP, like I was saying, most of the things that they come out with will do good anyway because again they're from the big three. But people will be like, oh my god, like when CLC came out with Hobgoblin, is that what it's called? That Goblin song. But oh my god, this concept is popping, like it suits them so well, why are people sleeping on them? They get success, but like in amongst foreigners, I guess. But I think a lot of people equate success to getting number one on music shows. And the thing is, concepts like that don't do well generally in Korea. Groups like 4MINUTE, they pulled it off. But then again, that's 4MINUTE, and they were around for years before they, you know, disbanded, sadly. That was hard times. So yeah, a lot of people kind of get the wrong impression that just because they like a song, they think that it's gonna do well. In terms of like Korean music, a lot of them don't do that well, like honestly. So I really do think the best that you can do is just support your favorite artists and try to buy their albums, but you know, even that can only do so much. Artists don't make money at all. Well, they make some money, but they don't make that much money from album sales. A lot of money comes in from like advertising deals, things like that. One thing that you can really tell that a group did is successful in Korea is if you see them in advertising, like outside, like on billboards and things. Twice, you see them everywhere. Big Bang, you see them everywhere. Girls' Generation, you see them everywhere. But you know, from what I know, BTS is huge in popularity, and no matter what people will say, they're pretty much like at this point, like head to head with EXO now, because it's common sense now that they're both doing really well, of course. And the thing is, EXO, you see them everywhere in advertising, but BTS, in the time that I've lived in Korea, I've been in Korea since they debuted, I've only ever seen them in one, like, shoe commercial. So, you know, with them, because their fan base is gigantic, like, overseas, they're gonna do well. They're gonna make a lot of money from album sales, etc, etc. I mean, they also have a ton of fans in Korea, too, so, but it's more so, like, the younger generation, which, you know, is a common thing. It's not new information. So yeah, what I'm trying to say is it's a dog-eat-dog world out there, girl. Yeah, there's some like shady ass business in the K-pop world. I was so surprised when I heard like all this information, all this tea that was being spilled. Oh my god, this looks terrible with this hair color. But yeah, anyway, next time you go to a music video and you see comments like, oh my god, why didn't this do so well? Why didn't they get number one? I don't understand. It's just that it's probably just not Korean sounding enough, like when it comes down to it. There are groups that have done like not exactly Korean sounding music that have gone popular from other things, like Stellar. Their music video for Marionette, of course, we all know why that got popular. Groups like Crayon Pop, their little helmet thing, their Jumping and Jump Everybody. That song became really popular amongst like a very certain type of group of people from like the interwebs. And so it was very weird stuff. Paint Pot, Soft Ochre, fucking worse. Basically what I'm trying to say is a lot of groups that you think are gonna do well don't actually do that well in terms of like in Korea. But that doesn't really matter, right? Because lately a lot of companies have been promoting their artists more so overseas. If it's like they can't get any fans in Korea, then maybe they'll get fans in the overseas market. So it all just depends on like what the company wants. If the company wants to be popular in Korea but they don't exactly get any recognition in Korea but they get a lot of recognition overseas, it just depends, because sometimes they don't really care for that. So sometimes you'll see if they fail in Korea but you know they have a bunch of foreign fans, you'll see them maybe like disappear. That's probably because they didn't do that well in Korea, which is a sad thing, because even with like Double A and the group that I was in, you know when you see a group debut and you're like, oh bitch, they're gonna fucking pop off, because the song is so good, right? Take the case of like Double A. Their debut song was, okay, in my opinion, was absolutely amazing. But, you know, a lot of things happen companies and, oh, it's the modern Renaissance palette. A lot of things happen within the companies that just cause these groups to just, not fuck up, but like, basically fuck up. But it's, of course, it's not the artist's fault. It's usually the management's fault. Ada was telling me, actually, their debut song, Michi Sogure, wasn't actually supposed to be their debut song. There's just a bunch of stuff involved. But at the end of the day, it's all a fucking business. And that's just the sad reality of it. But a lot of people don't want to face reality. Especially in this generation where a lot of people don't want to face reality and they want to flock to their safe spaces and things of that nature. But there's nothing you can do about it. So all we can hope for is that our faves just do well. Yeah. So I use Raw Sienna and Burnt Orange in my crease. My friend, oh my god, my two best friends in California, they have the cutest cats ever. But when I came back to Korea and I was putting my makeup away, I didn't realize how much cat fur gets all over the place. And then I'm gonna use Red Ochre all over my lids. I just want to put an even layer, even if it's a thin layer, all over my mobile lid. Okay, and then in the outer corner, I'm going to use Cypress Umber, the deep brown shade in there. Oh, this shit is too damn powerful. Don't like just a little bit. I'm very like nonchalant about my makeup because, in my opinion, I don't see a lot of it on my eye when my eyes are open anyway, so I just need to make sure it's for the most part blended and like on there. But I've never, as you guys know, I've never been so like technical and like super precise when it comes to looks like this, especially when it comes to more smoky eyes. I feel like you have a lot, oh fuck, I feel like you have a lot more wiggle room. And a lot of people will just see that as being unprofessional, and I've probably never fucking said I was professional. Probably the last person you want to take your makeup advice from, to be honest. And then I'm going to use, instead of Cypress Umber, I'm going to use Warm Taupe on the outer corner so it's a little bit softer. Actually, maybe take Cypress Umber on that same brush. More of like a liner effect out here. Okay, so after that, I'm gonna take a few matte shadows. I'm actually gonna put them on top to add a little bit more like dimension. I'm gonna take this shade called Amorous Alloy, and I'm gonna place that on the outer corner, sort of. And then I'm gonna take Mythology, and I'm gonna put that, layer that on top of like the inner corner color. And then in the very inner corner, I'm gonna use Jest. Not too much though, because if I really wanted this shade to really pop out, then I don't see the point in putting like all those other colors beneath, you know what I mean? So I'm using this as more of like a top coat sort of dealio, I suppose. chest on the inner corner. I love it. I love it. All right. And then as usual, a really quick coat of mascara, mostly just because I want to darken my lashes a little. And if I got any like powder on it from either my face powder or the eyeshadow, then that will help kind of clean it up, I guess, because I'm trying to pull the powder off your lashes. It's not really a fun experience, so. And then my nose, which actually is still a little, the swelling here is pretty much gone, I think. But here, a lot of there's still a little bit of swelling, so I'm gonna use this Bobbi Brown shadow in Sable. I went to Sephora and I saw the Kevin Aucoin sculpting powder, and I really wanted it, but I don't know, it's just really, really expensive. So when I went to the airport coming back to Korea, I saw this and it seemed similar, so she just picked that shit up. One thing I'm excited for though is this e.l.f. brush. This contouring brush. This is very similar to that Etude House brush I showed in that one video, but I think this is more proper for contouring. But this is like the perfect shape if you are a nose contour person. And you can also use, it's also a really good shape for getting that jawline pitch. Oh my god. Or even like if you do under the cheekbones. But I'm just gonna take one side and dip it in and really take that shit off because she's powerful. And then using the side that doesn't have product, kind of blend it out. One side effect of, not really side effect, but one thing that happened, it's probably gonna go away at some point, is after the surgery, what I noticed that the skin on my nose got kind of like my skin kind of changed. Not in biology, I almost said in biology, but it just kind of changed. It became a little bit more dry rather than oily. So you can see it's kind of almost crusty looking. Hopefully that will go away over time and then it goes back to normal. Throughout the day, it kind of gets better. When the oils in my nose start settling in, the powders that are on top of it do look a little bit better. They're not as like crusty looking. One thing that I used to use like back in the day was like the Bare Minerals Well Rested under eye. I guess it's a concealer. I think it was like an eyeshadow or something, but I really liked using it under my eyes and that really made me look awake. Okay, and then I think I'm almost done. I just need to put highlighter in my lip color. Girl, you need to just make it forever. Oh my god, I'm so fucking excited. Alright, first of all, bitch. Jeez, oh, you can't even see because it's so blinding. Oh my fucking god. Nope. Mm-mm, no ma'am. No, ma'am. Oh my. Bye. Annyeong. Makeup Forever, that is not okay. That is not. That's rude. Makeup Forever, that is fucking rude. And then last but not least, I am gonna put on this. I used this a lot when I was in California. I used it like almost every day. The Laneige lip tint. I talked about this in my February favorites. The cherry one. I fucking. It's actually the darkest color in the collection, but when you actually put it on, it's more of like a natural sort of color. Not natural, but it's more wearable. My lips are really, really pink because I was testing a Peripeta lip tint, and their tints are not fucking around with their lip tint. They do not come off, and they're really affordable, which is great. That video should be up. I guess after this video, maybe? We'll see. And then last but not least, did I say the last step was a lip? This is the last step. My Urban Decur All-Nighter Spray. Not completely necessary because I feel like with the base and the powder and all that, it lasts well all day, but because I bought this, I'm just gonna use it. It does actually work pretty well as a setting spray. It's just, the price tag is a little painful. The NYX one, the NYX setting spray, the matte one is just as good, so. If you need a setting spray, I think that one's a pretty good one. And a lot of people are always like, oh my god, Edward, why do you spray so much? But no, why? Sometimes. But the thing is, even though the mist is super, super fine and like soft, it actually doesn't spray that. It only sprays like that much. So you have to spray quite a bit to like cover your face. So that's why it looks like I'm spraying way too much. But I'm gonna do my hair really quick and put on my clothes and I'll be right back. All right, so that is the finished look. I hope you guys enjoy that video. Again, if there's any products that you are curious about, I'll have them in down below in the info bar. And with that, I will see you in my next video. 안녕, bye bye. So it shouldn't be that hard to swallow. The other chick I'm with never complaining. She make me wanna leave the one I'm with, Usher Raymond. Probably didn't register, don't trip, later on it will. Shorty full of drama like gangster Grizzles. I finally noticed it, it finally hit me like Tina did.